I think let's thank the speaker once again. The next talk is going to be given by Dr. Kavita, and he's from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, for reaching 70. And this has been two wonderful days for us, who are his former students, to see that these people, I mean, these are people, Mr. Ramakrishnan, Krishnamurti, Bhaskaran, Professor Rais, Professor Bhatt, I can see so many of our teachers actually here, and they shape condensed matter physics for us and made it so exciting to work on. And yesterday, Professor Ramakrishnan talked about the fact that he belonged to, and he was always lucky to be in an institute, good institutions, and I can see that the institutions are built by them. So, what I will talk about is something that people are interested in. A few years back, because these are systems where you have triangular lattices, and these are strongly correlated systems, we believe. And the way I came here was that there was a system called gadolinium iodide, which was a very German system in the sense that it was prepared in Stuttgart and modeling was being done in Dresden and nowhere else. And so I joined Professor Fulde and we were working together for some years on that. We published a couple of papers, but then we realized that this is not just a singular system. One has to look at older systems which have similar properties, physical properties and electronic properties. And then by then these papers of Kava and Princeton Group's papers on the superconductivity in dichalcogenide came out. And we realized that this is another system where one has to look at with similar methods. And so that brought us here. My collaborators are my student Kole, Mukul Lad, who is here. Vidyadhir Raya was here in the morning. And this is the paper that we have some of the results here in this paper. Okay, so these are old systems. Like transition metal dichalcogenides, which is the
this one. This like forward, previous, center one, laser.
Mm-hmm. So transition metal dichalcogenides are nearly 40-year-old systems. There is a transition metal atom. It forms a triangular lattice, separated by two layers of chalcogen atoms, selenium, sulfur, and so on. The essential feature is that most of the electronic activity happens in this 2D triangular lattice of transition metals. These systems were originally interesting systems because there is a CDW in almost all of these systems. Now they have found superconductivity in many of them actually. I will come back to it. I will show you where they found. These are partially filled D-band at the fermi level. It's mostly D1 and D0 configuration. So there are two polytypes, 1T and 2H, and these systems exhibit both incommensurate and commensurate CDW at moderately high temperatures. There are reports now of normal to superconductor transition with pressure and doping or intercalation. The normal transport of these systems, which is where we came in first, is very unusual. So the comparison with high TC has been in order for the last few years. So this is the structure. These are the two polytypes, 1T and 2H, the red are the transition metal atoms. The green are the transition metal atoms. The red is the transition metal atom, they form a triangular lattice. So this is the table for series of systems that we intend to study, and we believe that there is a general feature in all of them which one has to look at rather than looking at them individually. So we chose two systems. So we have studied this system, and we are now studying this system. This is the one where superconductor. What these people did. people, the, nobody has to check that. So the belief is that we, in this case at least, people have killed the superconductivity and brought it down and saw that CW persists.
Craig, can I also ask a clarifying question? In the 2H polycut,
yeah.
So is the wave vector the same in the two different commensurate
phases? It's the same, yes.
Then the symmetry is different. One is
orthologous. That's correct. Yeah.
These people
also calculated the low temperature resistivity as a function of temperature, as a function of pressure also, and this T power n is what is being plotted here. And as you can see, even at less pressures, they never recovered the value of 2. This is the phase diagram of detailed phase diagram of this doped compound. And this also becomes, as you see, this looks very much like the high TC superconductors. There is this unstable region. It becomes superconductor at low temperature. And this metallic phase is fairly unusual. This is from Kumar Sewa again, and what she did was that she had this both doping and pressure axis. So if you can look, if you see, the phase diagram is very, very similar on both sides, and here they had come down all the way up to here to see that the CDW persists till fairly low temperature. And interesting thing is that the RH values are different at the signs are different in these two regions. Okay, so let me come back to this system. There has been a lot of recent data on this, apart from in TIA-C2 as well. So these are features that I have just described. The interesting thing is that the CDW phase is more metallic. Even the commensurate CDW phase is more metallic than the normal state. So there is absolutely no question, no signature of a metal insulator transition in these systems. The ratio of these two resistivities vary from 30 to 50. Resistivity is fairly linear, almost up to 600 degree Kelvin, starting from the CW transition. There is no perceptible gap observed in the furnace, at the furnace surface in the CW phase. The band dispersion doesn't seem to see anything at the TCDW. There is a report of a nesting vector that Borisenko has reported, that he sees a nesting vector, but this is nowhere near the CDWQ vector. No indication of strong phonon coupling in this. We'll come back to this. And this all the spectroscopic data actually fit beautifully with the K-independent local sigma omega. Feeling, this is 2HTAC2, so D has 1. So these are the structures I mentioned. This is 2HTAC2. Nowadays you get much better picture. This is for TIAC2. So these shaded and empty circles are the seleniums at the top and bottom of the triangular lattice of titanium, and so their displacements in the CDW phase, commensurate phase, is being shown here. Yes?
I mean, you mentioned about filling.
Yes?
It's 3D0, right? Titanium.
Titanium is 3D0, tantalum is 3D1, TA.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's D1 or D0? These are the two that you get mostly. So these are very recent experiments, which I will come back to. These are mostly coming from this flash group, flash experiment at Hamburg. And what they are looking at is they are doing basically ARPOS experiments, but with time resolutions. So every few femtoseconds, they are doing an ARPOS experiment. So they pump the system with a laser, high power laser, and then excite it, and then look at the decay as through their ARPOS experiment. So it's a dynamical ARPOS in some sense. And what they claim is that this splitting is actually a representative of the CDW, And if you think of this as some CDW order parameter, here, for example, this is no laser, no pumping, and as you pump up, as you first, then you pump, and then this splitting is actually disappears within about 21 picosecond or so. So the scale at which the long range order disappears locally is exceedingly fast, and it's beyond all Phonon scales. Okay, let me skip this. This is another example in Nature. This paper came in Nature recently, and this is again from the same laboratory. And what they're seeing is that, so here, for example, it's a bit complicated. So this backfolded band is a representative of the CDW. And what you do is that you start measuring this as a function of temperature, as a function of time, and you start from here, and you see that this backfolded band is almost vanishing, and it vanishes within about 30 femtoseconds or so. It's an even faster measurement. And if you convert this time scale to some energy scale, this energy scale is far ahead, far above any Phonon scale in the system. This is the ARPES data about 10 years back, 12 years back, and then this actually saw first time reported that there is no gap at the Fermi surface. So what they did is that she went along these three parallel lines. So these are the three graphs for them in the Brillouin zone from gamma to the band edge K, so there are these Fermi arcs that you are supposed to encounter from LDA calculations, and the data show no presence of any Fermi arc. This is even better. So this is done at two temperatures. One is at high temperature, above CDW, and the other one is below. And here, this is being done away from the Fermi level. There is no gap at the Fermi level. This is where the Fermi level is. So 0.44, you see there is almost no difference between the two at the leading edge. But if you go away from the Fermi surface, there seems to be a gap that opens up. So this is again the same, but this is at the Fermi surface now, and these two temperatures above, below and above the CDW transition, and you see there is absolutely no gap. And these are the points where they measure it. This is A, B, and C, and so on. This was an older one. This was about 10 MeV or so. But now you have 0.1 degree resolution, 5 MeV in energy, and 0.1 degree in angle. Borisenko's data, for example. And even he doesn't see any. So this is how it goes as a function of K. So at KF, there is almost nothing, no gap. And if you look at that so-called gap, or at least the shift of the leading edge, then this is how it goes away from the KF. It just rises away from the KF. So they tried to fit it with a BCS kind of form, and the BCS goes like this, and the actual data are like this. This is as a function of temperature. This is Borisenko's experiment. Now here, what he does is that he actually goes all these lines that are shown, he traverses all these lines in his ARPES, and he tries to look at the anisotropy of this leading edge shift, as well as most of the people see that this valence band top actually comes down as you come down in temperature, and he actually plots it. So he sees two things. One is that the leading edge shift, and the leading edge shift he plots here, and this he calls a band gap, and this he calls a pseudo gap. So both he plots here, and both of them increase as the temperature is lowered. What is more interesting is that if you look at these different traversals, then this traversal, the gap is very highly anisotropic, whereas here it's more or less uniform. So the photoemission intensity in the CDW state was also measured. This was in 2000, And I will come back to this. This is an interesting graph. And they actually traversed in this direction. And this, as you can see, the dispersion goes to the Fermi level without being affected at all by the CDW. So the message from ARPOS is this, that there are no indication of nesting in this charge density wave, no gap in the CDW phase. The leading edge shift is far away from the Fermi surface. The LDA fits ARPOS reasonably well. This is interesting. Actually, the LDA data, if you look at the LDA data, they fit the ARPOS reasonably well, except that the line shapes are all wrong, in the sense that the actual line shape is very broad. This is something I showed from Borisenko's data, and this comes out of the so the imaginary part of sigma, and this also is coming out of the ARPOS experiment. But the imaginary part of sigma is fairly linear of the CDW temperature. So this is the resistivity of all these systems. This is the one I was discussing, and as you can see, I will have a better plot here. See the resistivity starting from here. On the left side, which is below the CDW transition, it comes down, it becomes more metallic. On this side, it remains almost linear, like the high-TC systems. And these are the two places, which is in an enlarged scale, where the transitions take place. This still has a kink, whereas this is completely insensitive to the transition. So basically, something is happening which is in the CDW state, which is not being recognized by the electronic structure or the transport. So this is interesting. This is optical conductivity. And as you can see, the optical conductivity, as temperature goes down, there is a sort of Doodle peak that picks up. But what is interesting is that till up to 10,000 centimeter inverse, beyond an EV, there is a broad spectral weight that remains. The spectral weight gets transferred towards left as you lower the temperature. So DC transport and real part of sigma tell us CDW does not affect the transport at all. The specific image measurement also shows no effect at all. It's insensitive to TC. It appears to be a bad metal. If you naively calculate the mean free path, it turns out to be almost a lattice spacing in the C direction. So it's of course in the region of the IFA rail criterion breaks down. There is a Drude-like peak, so it's metallic, of course, quote unquote again. And what is interesting is that the weight being transferred towards lower frequency means that there is a freezing of scattering at low energy. So the coherence is being restored in some sense below the transition rather than above the transition. So above the transition, it seems to remain non-Fermi liquid like high TC materials. So this is where Dines actually had a beautiful article on this. What he did is that he actually tried to measure this quantity as a function of both omega and temperature. I don't have the temperature, different temperature graphs are shown here. So he tried two things. He tried to see how the spectral weight gets shifted. And he also looked at what omega you have to go to recover the number of particles, at least the LDA number of particles. And on both counts, it's very interesting that the weight gets transferred, as you can see, at lower temperature to lower frequencies. And if you want to recover the entire number of carriers that LDA gives, you have to go up to about 12 mV to do it. It's an enormously large scale. So the spectral weight distribution is exceedingly broad. It's non-zero. The recovery, as I said, is quite uncertain. One doesn't know at 12, this data at 12 EV is whether it's reliable or not. Anyway, so the recovery is extremely uncertain. Considerable redistribution takes place with temperature. There is a large spectral weight towards far infrared as temperature is lowered. And nothing abrupt happens again as you cross the CDW transition. Now Dines went forward and he tried to calculate a transport lifetime, And from here, what he does is that he plots this as a function of temperature at three temperatures. This is above, this is close to CdW, and this is below CdW. And as you can see, the transfer of spectral rate is visible here clearly, because at 300 degree Kelvin, the coherence that I was talking about, the low frequency coherence, is low temperature, low frequency coherence, is shifted higher up here. So at low temperature, the coherence seems to set in from here, around here. At high temperature, it sets in here. And beyond that, it's almost linear. He also plots, it's I think a high DC Hannon, the linear in omega graph, and he says that this thing is above it, at below certain frequency, and it just crosses that line at certain frequency, which is about 2000 centimeter inverse. And this is the, I think this is C, this is AB plane, and this is C. Now this is also AB. This is TASC2, this is NBASC2. The C axis behaves like this. Here again, it's sort of, it never saturates, never comes down. I mean, it's almost, it sort of comes down slowly and never saturates. So from transport, if you look at the scattering lifetime, it's strongly frequency dependent. Rapid suppression of both the scatterings happen below a characteristic frequency, which is about 500 centimeter inverse at low temperature. So this is an indicator of a pseudo gap kind of thing that is happening probably. The high and low T gamma AB cross each other at some frequency. There's no saturation even up to 0.5 UV, and both of them are above the linear gamma linear curve up to about 2000 centimeter inverse. We come back to here because this actually gives me another lifetime, which is the so-called quasi-particle lifetime. So one fits this with a intensity of this kind, picks up a k-independent sigma, the self-energy from here, and then tries to fit with the sigma omega, which is k-independent, all the other data that you have at different k's. So I will show the data, but here what they have done is that in this graph, they have plotted this scattering lifetime, the so-called quasi-particle scattering lifetime, as a function of temperature. As you can see, these shaded circles are that. This is plotted like this. So about transition temperature, it becomes linear. This is the one that Dynes had obtained from the transport, and this is the resistivity. So all of them sort of match beautifully with a scale factor of 6.4 used here. And this is what they find what in the previous graph I showed, that they have taken a sigma of omega which is k independent, and then they came back and fitted all these graphs, all the data, with a single sigma omega, and the fit seems to appear beautiful. I mean, it fits almost all of them. What else they did on? Yeah. So what they also looked at this kink. I mean, if you look at this, there is a kink here, and this kink is reminiscent of some collective mode appearing there. And so what they do is that they plot the sigma of imaginary part of sigma as a function of omega, and they say that they find that at around 70 MeV, there is a dip in the imaginary part of sigma. There is a peak in the in the real part of sigma, which correspond beautifully to the, to this scale. If you look at this, this king appears at around 75 MeV. So that scale and this other scale match beautifully. This scale. So the message from here is that the self-energy is local, no k-dependence. These are already discussed. So there is the 65 to 70 MeV peak in the real part, and the T dependences of imaginary part of sigma and transport lifetime match beautifully. Coming back to electronic structure, the electronic structure is fairly simple. There is the Fermi level goes through the D band. in this material, and it's half filled. So we tried to do a calculation for these systems, and we asked these questions: what causes the incoherence in these systems in the normal state, and then if there is this normal state is incoherent, what is the mechanism for the instability to set in, the CDW or superconductivity? So because we believe that this is a strong coupling system, there is no signature of phonon. See, 65 to 70 MeV is fairly larger, 2 to 3 times larger than any phonon scale in that system, 2HTOSE2. So whatever is happening should not be happening because of phonons. That's what we believe. And also these lifetime measurements, these dynamical RPS measurements, also told us that the time scales are so fast that it has to be an electronic mechanism rather than a phonon-driven mechanism. So this is the question that we ask. And the theory that we do, the calculation that we do, we basically take it as a strongly correlated system, use this local sigma omega, and once you have a local sigma omega, dynamic and mean field theory is a natural tool to work on, with lens itself. And so what we did is that we took the two bands at the Fermi level and did a multi-orbital dynamic and mean field theory. For the MPLD solver, we used IPT. And then we analyze, we try to write down an effective Hamiltonian for the system. Okay, so this is the band structure. What we do is that we pick out the LCA, LDA fit, the tight binding fit, LCAO fit, and the fit is quite okay. Okay, let me skip this. And this is the Fermi surface that we get. It just beautifully, it's quite excellently matches with Borisenko's one. Okay, so we start with this Hamiltonian. This Hamiltonian is very simple in the sense that we have two bands, the D and the P bands, which cross the Fermi level. There is a U and there is an UAB between the two bands. And then we run the multi-orbital DNFT, and this is what we get as a function of the TAB was set to 4.4 EV. Now as you see that there is a pseudo gap that starts appearing as you hike up your U and UAB. This is the photoemission that we calculate from there. So this is the integrated photoemission. And this peak is quite reasonably modeled. This one we could not, but there is another one which is here that we believe has been overlooked by the people. By a more accurate data will probably reproduce this. This is like a lower Hubbard band. So, and these are the ones that are from Liu's data, and they sort of fit quite well. But this was this Borisenko's band gap. So this is the band gap that Borisenko calculated, and this is what we do. This is our calculation, and from this calculation actually we fit the parameters. So we fit this value with his value, and then we run the rest of the program, rest of the calculation, and then all of them match quite well with this these values that Borisenko get. If I actually had set this TAB equal to 0, even the P band would have crossed the Fermi level. So the fact that there is a finite TPD is quite interesting, that it sort of ensures that there is a finite TPD. This is our optical conductivity. How much time do I have?
You have 10 minutes.
Okay, this is our optical conductivity for this system. And as you can see, the broad peak, the broad spectral weight is visible quite easily. This Drude peak at low temperature is coming up. Spectral weight is getting transferred. There is a shoulder kind of behavior at around, it persists for a long time. This is interesting. This is the transport, this raised UDC transport. And as you can see, the system was, the resistivity is coming down almost linearly. And then at around 300 Kelvin, it starts going up, and then there is a sort of a coherence that sets in and brings it down rapidly. And there is never a T-square behavior that is seen in this. These are the scattering lifetimes, divided by a sigma, and as you can see, there is a huge linear part to it. So now what we believe is happening is that this, because of this interband exchange term, there is a interband overlap, there is a strong excitonic exchange, and we believe that the system actually is in a preformed excitonic liquid state at high temperature. So excitons have formed, but they are not condensed, and these excitons are the quasi particles are scattering against these excitons, and that leads to this incoherent normal state. And once you come down in temperature, slowly at certain temperature, the excitons start condensing. So once they condense, they of course are removed from the scattering channel, and then the scattering starts dropping. And that's where the coherence starts setting in. So it actually has the preformed excitons and their condensation work in two different ways at high temperature and low temperature in determining the transport.
Let's say for PI, CO2, the exciton picture is clear because you have a filled D band and an empty band. So you can imagine exciton picture.
Yeah, so one
from here.
Huh?
So you, in the tantalum, as you said, there is 5D1.
Right. Yeah, but once you start your DNFT, you will immediately see that first of all, the pseudo gap kind of thing opens up. Then the P bands goes below the Fermi level. Okay. So now, if you have a TAB, you can have scattering between this and the D band, and you can form a hole and the electron pair using this. Pardon? So it's typically about 1 eV, it's close to the bandwidth. Yeah, that we fitted it from you cannot fit from the so there's no way you can fit you have to fit you from some experimental data, right? So we fitted it from Borisenko's graph that the BG, that the band gap that he gave at 20 Kelvin, we fitted it from there and then we fixed it there and allowed the other calculations to go through. So this is the excitonic amplitude. As you can see, the excitonic amplitude sort of rises as you come down in temperature, and around 100 degree it starts going up. This is the spectral function, excitonic spectral function, and as you can see, as you decrease the temperature, the peak develops and becomes more coherent. You can also calculate electronic Raman. Unfortunately, there are no data for this. So what we see is that the Raman is very broad at high temperature, and as the temperature comes down, it sort of picks up and become sharply picked. So I'm almost done. So the CDW phase, there is almost a real gap that opens up here at low temperature. So this is the excitonic CDW that we are talking about. This is the CDW amplitude, that is how it goes. It's sort of finite even above the transition temperature, which is here, but then it drops rapidly around 300 degree Kelvin. This is in the CDW state, the transport lifetimes. As you can see, that the lifetimes of the scattered, if there are quasi particles, the lifetime is very linear with temperature. So the conclusion for 2HTAAC2 is that we believe it's a preformed excitonic liquid in high temperature, and then at low temperature the CDW forms not through the usual route of electron phonon interaction, but through the condensation of this excitons. The normal state is incoherent, dominated by this incoherent scattering. So the LRO CDW does not affect resistivity much at its transition temperature, because most of the Fermi surface is already eaten away by these preformed excitons. Self energy is local, and so these are things that naturally come out. What we have not looked at is superconductivity from an incoherent excitonic liquid via this condensation. We are actually looking at it, how does it appear. Briefly, let me show you what happens in TiAC2. This is a similar graph for the TiAC2 for this time resolved RPS experiment, and here also people see the scales are exceedingly large. Although the optical data from Zahid Hassan and company, they find in the optical spectrum there are signatures of phonon at low frequency. So this system, people believe there is a strong electron-phonon coupling, at least exciton-phonon coupling is there. And this is not really a system where only correlation is important, you have electron-phonon coupling also. But the fact that the time scales are again exceedingly small tells us that there is a strong electron-electron interaction too. So one actually then can model it, as Bhaskaran was pointing out, this is the situation in TiSe2. It's a D0 system. And one can run the dynamical mean field theory calculation. Here we actually couple the phonons. There is an exciton phonon coupling. We do the calculation, and this is what we find as from our calculation. As you can see, these are data from Philip Obi. And this is the valence band. This is at low temperature. This is close to the transition. Here the transition is at around 200 degree Kelvin. So at around transition, this thing goes up and almost merges with the Fermi level. And at much above the transition temperature, there is a strong weight here at the Fermi level. And actually the D weight also contributes to this. So what we see is exactly same. It's much below here. Then it starts going up, and at the Fermi, transition temperature, there is a strong weight at the Fermi level. And the corresponding Fermi surface actually reproduces the experimental Fermi surface quite well. So the Fermi pockets get eaten up at low temperature, but then they reappear at high temperature, and that's what we also see. The transport again this is from Kurmatseva. And if you look at this transport, I mean, this is due to impurity and all that. What we get is, of course, behavior like this. Again, the same mechanism seems to be working. You have an excitonic liquid here. The excitons seem to condense here, around somewhere here. And then the resistivity rapidly drops. Yes? Yes, at 200 degree here. Yeah, it's here. Below the transition. Yeah. Slightly below the transition. Yeah. But this is still at 1.1 gigapascal. So and this is without any. Okay. And this is Zahid Hasan's data. Their group's data. These are the data from their group. And what is beautiful here is that you can see that how the spectral wave behaves. The spectral wave starts going down at low temperature. It's up to 150 degree it comes down, and then it starts rising again. So this is really remarkable in this system. And I don't have time to explain all this now. There are two features they note is that there is a broad peak here at 0.4 eV. And if you extrapolate that here, they claim that this signifies a very small gap around 0.15 eV. They claim that this system is actually going from a semi-metal to a semi-metal. So this controversy was there for a long time. Whether it's a semiconductor to semi-metal or a semi-metal semiconductor to semiconductor and so on, they seem to believe that it is both sides are semi-metal. And this is our DMFT data, and as you can see, it again has this feature that at around 150K, there is a reversal of trend and just goes up. Okay, thank you. So I think I will stop here. I mean, I will not discuss the phonons, the shift of phonon mode and all that. So let me thank and stop. I can't hear.
Excited picture maybe appealing.
Can you just give the mic? Can I come back?
There's magnetic susceptibility data at Bell Labs, which shows a very clear anti-ferromagnetic like behavior. So that, and we reproduced that recently, and we're actually trying to look at the nonlinear susceptibility, and we didn't see anything within our experimental results. Uh-huh. But I surveyed the literature recently, but none of the others show any.